Father God, we thank you for humor, Lord, but also the reminder to share our faith, the treasures that are prepared for us in your kingdom. What was it like to be around Paul the Apostle? A man that they stoned with stones at Lystra, and he hops back up and goes right back into town. What was it like to hear his heart to Timothy for this world? And now, Lord, it's our turn. We read last week, last day's perilous times will come. May we be equipped and strengthened, Lord. May our hearts be stirred to truly live different lives, to be witnesses, Lord. You know those times when we've had the opportunity, we didn't take it. And yet you are so faithful to give us more chances, Lord. May we be bold and not afraid. May we truly walk with you in the Spirit. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy. And we pray that you would be with us now. In Jesus' name, amen. Chapter 3, verse 10, to get us back into our text here. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, my teaching, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. And Timothy was an eyewitness to these things, how Paul had conducted himself. You also fully know the persecutions, the afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch. This is in Turkey, Antioch in Syria. At Iconium, at Lystra, where they had stoned him. You also know what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned. That would be the apostles' doctrine, things that Christ had taught them, and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, not only what he heard, but watching Paul's life equal what he taught, that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation. How? Through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. And so we ended here. All scripture, not the parts we like, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God, theopneustos, divinely breathed. And it is profitable for doctrine or teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction, righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Paul is leaving. He says to Timothy, come before winter, so we're sometime in perhaps the late summer, maybe like right now, early September. Shipping will stop in about a month or so. Gets too dangerous. Come before the winter when they would no longer be able to sail. And so it's probably the late fall or fall of 67. Paul beheaded in 68 before the end of June, because Nero died in the end of June of 68. So somewhere in the summer of 68, perhaps early June, Paul beheaded for his faith. So he's got less than a year, probably more like maybe 6-8 months. And he knows he's leaving the scene, and he's written these chapters to Timothy, the second letter that he wrote to him, to say, listen, I'm gone. You're going to take the torch. You're going to carry this baton forward to the next generation of the church to oversee. It's not that he's just a new member to the congregation. Timothy is to be one of the overseers to help guide the work of God, to keep it faithful to the teachings of Christ and faithful to Scripture, not get caught up in the heresies and the false teachings and the nonsense and the wrangling, worthless arguments. And so he lets them know that the scripture is given by inspiration of God. We can trust it. It's for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction. It has been said, and you probably know this, but the Jews said that God's word was given through men, but superintended by the Holy Spirit. And so their writings were without error. The Jews essentially just took that for granted, that it was God-given. The Bible that you hold in your hand was written over 1,600 years, over 60 generations, by more than 40 authors on 3 different continents. And yet, if you've read enough of it, you'll realize it truly speaks with one voice. From Genesis to Revelation, it speaks with one voice. We were working with the Sunday school teachers who were going to start teaching Revelation to the students, to the kids. And we put up on the board there, you know, Genesis explains how we got here. God created us, how man fell into sin. Revelation explains why we need God, because God will judge sin and bring his wrath upon this world for its wickedness. And in between Genesis and Revelation, praise God, is God's plan and God's revealing how he died for sin to pay for it. So Genesis, how we got here, how sin came into the world. Revelation, the fact that God will one day judge these things. And between those two is the plan of God unfolding in salvation for us to believe by faith. It's one voice, one book. And so chapter 4, I charge thee, therefore before God. Is that serious? I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice he equates them. Who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Turn to Matthew 25. Left turn. Matthew 25. We'll be in verse 31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a shepherd divideth the sheep from the goats. And he shall set the sheep on the right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Did you catch that? For I was hungered, you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? Or when saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? Or when saw we thee sick or in prison and came unto thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of these, the least of my brethren, you've done it unto me. So their work saved them? How many are unsure? Did their work save them? No. But because they were saved, what produced? Good works. This is James. You say you have faith, hey, you do well. You know, the devils say they have faith and they tremble, but they don't obey God. Here, these individuals, having faith in Christ, demonstrated during this time of tribulation and that they took care of Christ's brethren. They reached out, risking at times their very lives to do what Christ told us to do. They demonstrated their faith by their actions. Then shall he say also to them on the left hand, Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for who? Does that say men? What does it say? Prepared for the devil and his angels. There are two kingdoms. What are they? Kingdom of light and kingdom of darkness. There is no kingdom of gray, no airlock. There are two kingdoms, kingdom of light and the kingdom of darkness. You are in either one or the other. You decide which kingdom you are in by what you have done with Jesus Christ. If you've accepted him as your Savior into your heart by faith, he is the Son of God, he is God in human flesh, God is light. When we accept him into our lives by faith, we become children of the kingdom of light. But if you reject him, John chapter 3 made it clear, this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than the light. And they don't come to the light lest their deeds should be exposed. So you're in one of two kingdoms. If you're offended by that, take it up with God. But you're in one of two kingdoms this evening. And we never know when these things will begin to pour out on this earth. We're to look for earthquakes in diverse places. Let me know if you see any. Famines, pestilences, wars, rumors of wars, and a push towards global governance and global financial solutions, and global religion. Those are some of the hallmarks of the last days. And Israel will suddenly be regathered into the land. The Jews that have been scattered everywhere will return to Israel, and then the neighbors around them will seek to attack them, including countries, if you've ever heard of them, like Libya. Wonder where that regime change is going to take it. Iran. Turkey, Russia, and others? It's been a very interesting summer, hasn't it? Egypt has changed its leadership. Libya is about to have its leadership change if he hasn't fled the country already. There are mixed reports. Syria has got all kinds of troubles. Iran has been as unstable as always. And Putin wants back on the throne in Russia. Interesting time. Depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. If you refuse to come to the Lord and be in his kingdom of light by faith, then you are in the kingdom of darkness. You proved it, because when I was hungered, you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, you took me not in. Naked, you clothed me not. Sick and in prison, you visited me not. And then shall they also say, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered or a thirst or a stranger or naked or sick in prison, did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer him, saying, verily I say unto you, insomuch as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. These shall go away into everlasting. What did it say? Everlasting punishment. But the righteous into life eternal. Back to teaching the Sunday school teachers. Genesis declares that God has created us. He created us, the ability to choose. And man disobeyed one commandment and brought all of creation into sin with him. But God then sent his son to redeem us. But if you don't understand that there's a judgment of God coming, Revelation, what it spells out quite clearly, as well as this text that parallels it, that God is one day going to judge the nations and judge the sins of this world, if you don't know there's a judgment coming, or somehow you've denied it, then you feel no need to be redeemed. Who cares how I live? If there's no judgment, it doesn't matter, does it? There's no resurrection. Does it really matter? If that's once I die and that's it, I turn back to dust and there's no afterlife, then who cares how I live? But the Bible's clear. There is a life that is to come. And we spend it either in God's presence in the kingdom of light or rejected by him in the kingdom of darkness because we have rejected his salvation. It's one or the other. And words like everlasting are used for punishment. What good is it if you gain the whole world for 70, 80, 90 years here, Jesus said, but yet a man loses his own soul? What will a man give in exchange for his soul, he said? Your soul is worth more than all the stuff in this world. In fact, it was worth the blood of God's Son. This is what Paul is handing off to Timothy. These are the things he's to continue teaching and to admonishing within the churches, that they would be faithful to go and to tell others about God's wonderful salvation through his Son. And so I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, and the reminder there is a deadline coming, who shall judge the quick, that is the alive, and the dead, when at his appearing and his kingdom. What did Pilate say? Are you a king? What did Jesus say? Is as you say. But he said, but my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would fight. Pilate said, are you a king then? Yes. And he went out and said, no fault in him. He's not my jurisdiction. I don't care. But here the kingdom is going to come. What did he teach us to pray? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That was Matthew 25. His kingdom is coming. And when his kingdom comes, he's going to gather the nations, Daniel chapter 12. And he's going to judge them and divide them. Some will wake to everlasting life, Daniel 12 says, some to everlasting scorn and contempt or shame. There is a judgment coming. You can deny it all you want, but yet there's evidence of a global flood. We've already seen one judgment from God. There's a second one coming. And that's why we need to get out and tell people. He will judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Now, chapter 4, verse 1, I charge you there before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, comma. This is parenthetical. He's giving us information. Take chapter 4, verse 1. Let's go again. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Here is what he's charging him. Preach what? Preach the word. Not preach about the word. The Bible is your friend. Is that true? Sure. It is a wonderful companion to us. The Bible will set you free. Is that true? Sure, it's a wonderful thing. The Bible, you can trust this book. Is that true? Yes. It's great to preach and talk about the word, but it's much more effective to teach people what the word says. The other thing is, don't just simply preach from the word. Take a verse and then make it say whatever you want it to say. Or take two verses. You ever get on, remember the old days when they used to give you real food on the planes with silverware? Remember that? Remember that? Remember that? How many are old enough to remember that? Some planes will still do that, depending on where you are. No, actually LL in regular class, but yeah. Wow, these guys are good. Remember when they gave you like those tiny little beanie weenies? You know, they're supposed to be like a real meal and you pick it up and go. Remember that little stuff? That's what it's like when you go and you get one verse. You're ready for like a sandwich, you know, with the mustard and the meat and the mayo and the lettuce and all that. And you get Timothy. I charge you before God and before the Lord Jesus Christ, preach the word, not preach from the word and go where you want with it, not preach about the word, but never talk directly from it, preach the word. Why do we go chapter by chapter and verse by verse? Because that's what we're exhorted to do. Paul said to the Ephesian elders, I've declared to you the entire counsel of God. I'm innocent of all men's blood. I've told you what it says. And that means we're going to hit sections of the word that some people don't want to hear. But we need to know them. And they all reveal the heart of God. Preach the word. By the way, just you want a little pastor's aside. It's easier to go chapter by chapter, verse by verse. Shh. I know what next week's sermon's going to be. I can look back 5 weeks and figure out what that sermon was. I don't have to sit around and figure out acrostics and figure out themes that go together and start cutting and pasting verses and squeezing them in the fit and all that. I just keep walking. It's actually very easy. If you miss a week, you just read ahead or read behind. And you're back up to speed. Don't tell anybody. I watch these guys sometimes like, wow, that must have taken him hours. And people, wow. Not that I don't study, but preach the word. Be instant, be ready. In season, when it's convenient. Out of season, when it's not convenient. Be ready. Reprove, that always gets you on people's Christmas card list. That is to correct. Reprove with what? Well, love, but the word of God. Who cares what I think? I could be wrong. Wrong all the time. But when you reprove with the word of God, and the word of God is alive, sharper than any two-edged sword, and it's not the ideas of men, it's divinely breathed, then we know we can trust it. And it's profitable, again, for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. When we let the word of God be number one, the standard, but also the judge of our conduct, we're safe. When we have our own ideas, we're on thin ice. Reprove, rebuke, exhort. Little exhortation. When someone wants to talk to you, a fellow believer, they're having a struggle, just imagine emblazoned behind their head, it says, never mind what you think, what does the word of God say? They pour out their hearts, their problems, their struggles, never mind what I think. What does the word of God say? Because the word of God will set them free. Preach the word, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering. Because sometimes you keep having to exhort over and over again, and you're just like, oh. There were seasons long ago, and I guess maybe I've gotten smarter, where I would be dealing with people, and this is back, church was small, and a lot of people would show up at my doorstep, and now they show up here, which is good. But there are times I'm working full-time outside of her church and everything else. There are times my wife is pulling her hair out because she says, you know, I can tell just by walking by and looking at your face in your office, you're telling them the same thing you did last time. She said, why don't you next time take a little tape recorder, put it in there and hit record. Talk to them, go through the whole thing, and then when you're done, okay, they leave. And when they don't do it, and they come back, and they haven't done anything you asked them to, didn't take the word and apply it, now they're going to complain about the same thing, go, no problem, sit down, take out the tape recorder, hit play, and leave. Go back and play with your kids. Sometimes it's hard to reprove with long-suffering because sometimes we have to tell people the same thing over and over again. But again, over time, we learn something. If you come to us for help and we give you what the Bible says, now your issue is between you and God. And he's there all the time, 24/7, has open access every day, all week long, to talk to you and to convict you and to direct you. And so if we give you what God says and you decide you don't want to apply it, then you know what? You really don't want help. You want to just continue to be in that position that has you so uncomfortable. We should be long-suffering, but there's also time to say, person, Jesus, Jesus, person, you guys hang out, I'll be over here. You'll do better with him anyway. So do these things, Timothy. I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Preach the word, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine, teaching. Teach them what they need to know. You see, for the time will come when they will not endure sound teaching. You know, it's going to show up sometime soon. If you want an interesting experiment, go to some of the more popular folks out there teaching and just do a list of the sermon titles and see what are they teaching. Try it. It can be kind of eye-opening. What are they really teaching? There will come a time when they will not endure sound doctrine or teaching, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers who, for example, won't speak against their lust, but rather will make them feel good about their lusts, or worse yet, perhaps bend the word of God to accommodate their lusts. Is that going on? Yes, it is. But after their own lusts. So does that mean Paul and Timothy are better than everybody else? No, it means they're telling what God told them to tell them. Doesn't mean one's better than the other. We are giving you the word of God. It's between you and the author. After their own lust will they heap themselves teachers, having itching, tingling ears that want to be scratched with curious things. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, which means they're intentionally deaf to it. And they shall be turned unto fables. The big one is called evolution. But watch thou in all things, stay alert, endure afflictions, which Paul did. Do the work of an evangelist. Even if you're not, quote, an evangelist, you can still evangelize and tell people about the love of God. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of your ministry. Let me translate. Your turn. We've got verse 6 to verse 22. We've got what? 16 verses left? And Paul's finished. Watch in all things. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of your ministry. Let me give you how I was thinking about this during the week. Imagine Pastor Chuck, who's coming to visit in October 4th. We're excited to see him. Has already been put to death for his faith. Imagine Pastor Joe down there at Calvary Philly, my pastor, I appreciate him, has already been put to death for his faith, or is about to be put to death for his faith, and is saying now to us or to me or to you, we're done. It's your turn. That's what the final chapter of this letter is. I'm done. It's your turn. If it was in your hands, how would it go? Can you imagine Paul, he's dictating these things, they're recording them, he's sharing with them, watch in all things, Timothy, endure afflictions, do the work of evangelist, make full proof of your ministry, it's time, buddy. It was great to hide behind Paul, and Paul was the apostle overseeing the churches with some of the other apostles, but now he's going to be out of the scene. Not that just Timothy's someone in the pew, Timothy is one of the people the body of Christ is going to look to lead them now. That's heavy. If you're here and you have had your parents pass on and you went from being under that org chart of grandparent and parent and you were under that org chart, but finally the day comes when you're the top of the org chart and you have under you children or grandchildren or great-grandchildren, it's a very sobering reality to go, you know what, there's no one else in my family tree above me. I'm at the top. It means they're all looking to me, number one, and if the actuaries are right, I'm the next one to go. It's a sobering place to be. Watch, Timothy, endure afflictions. Give them the word of God. I charge you to do this. Don't hold back from admonishing them what is true and make full proof of your ministry. You see, because of verse 6, for I am now ready to be offered or poured out like a drink offering. I'm done. The time of my departure is at hand to take down or fold the tent, to loose the anchor and set sail. I'm finished. It's over. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. The idea is I have completed the course I am to run. I have completed the work that God has given me. I don't sense any regret here, do you? Did Paul make mistakes? Sure. Do we make mistakes? Sure. Do you ever think about this? We just went through the golden calf. It took us forever to get there, but Aaron is the guy who's basically the linchpin for the whole thing, yes? Who's going to become high priest? Say that again. Aaron. Does he deserve it? Are you kidding? So is there grace in the Old Testament? It's one book. I've fought the good fight. I have finished my course. I have not gone off track. I have not been disqualified. I have finished what God has given me to do. Do you know what God has given you to do, and are you doing it? Well, I'm not sure. Then get in the Word, abide in Him, and God will begin to move you. Well, I'm afraid to ask Him. Why? He might send me somewhere I don't want to go. Was Jonah better off going to Tarshish or Nineveh? Anybody? When he went to Tarshish, he paid for the ride. When he went to Nineveh, God arranged the transit. Where was he safer? Why are we so afraid to give to God anything He wants? Let's review for a minute. When was the last time God pulled something out of your life? Maybe an area He was refining you or purifying you, and He was telling you, you shouldn't have this anymore, you shouldn't have this anymore, and you're telling God why you should have it. No, it's okay, Lord. I'm a mature Christian. I can handle it. You shouldn't have this anymore. It's time for it to go. And finally, you give in. You handed it over to Him. Was there a joy? Yeah, when you really thought about it. And did He give you something so much better? Oh, yeah. Has that been pretty much His consistent record? Anytime God has weaned something, someone, some situation out of your life, and He's replaced it with something else, hasn't it always been something so much more fulfilling? Yeah. Then why would you ever be afraid to let God take you wherever He wants you or your family to go? Well, I feel called, but my husband doesn't. Or I feel called, but my wife doesn't. Listen, if God's calling you, He's going to call both of you. That's how He works. So start praying for the spouse who doesn't know. They'll get the message. You know, our missionaries to China, the wife was all set to go. The husband had been in the Vietnam War, had a discrimination issue with Asians. He admits it, told us when he shared his testimony. One day driving along the road, God just busted him about that prejudice, completely wiped his heart out. Now he loves the Asian world. He's over there all the time doing ministry. God had to deal with something in his heart to open him up to wherever God would take him. But you listen to him, you talk to him, and they're just overflowing with joy at the privilege to be the Lord's witness in whatever country He's taken them. We'd be A-okay with boarding up the doors here because the body is gone in the mission field and going to join you. We'd be fine with that. There are thousands, never heard. And one day all these things we're so worried about are going to pass away. Paul is able to say, you know what, I finished my course. I fought the good fight. I didn't leave anything on the, you know, on the mat, as we used to say in wrestling. I put everything into the match, and I'm done. I'm ready to go. I've given all God I have. I'd rather wear out for the Lord than hold it back and get no reward. I'd rather do that. So now I'm ready to be offered. My time of departure is at hand. I have no regrets. I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. And by the way, I have kept the faith. So now, Timothy, it's your turn. Henceforth, because I'm going to be poured out, because I'm leaving, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, because he has competed lawfully. He has not disqualified himself. There is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, a reward in heaven, which the Lord, the righteous judge, you know, there are still a few righteous judges in heaven, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all of them also that love his appearing, his return. Do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. Why? Because he's only got shortly to live. For Demas hath forsaken me. Interesting study. In Colossians 4:15 it says there Demas greets you. Philippians or Philemon 24 it says, Demas is a fellow laborer. Now, just a little later, Demas has forsaken me. What happened to Demas? Most feel it's perhaps he's forsaken, that he's unwilling to share the heat that Paul is under because he's considered a ringleader of those who caused the arson to the city of Rome, and so now it's very dangerous. Others say, no, he's gone into full apostasy, but Paul's heart very troubled. Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. He's been sidetracked and has departed unto Thessalonica. Crescens to Galatia. Titus to Dalmata, which is Yugoslavia for you and me. Titus had met Paul between his two imprisonments at Nicopolis, between his imprisonment there. You can read it in Titus 3:12. Titus now has gone off there to serve at Dalmata. Only Luke is with me. God bless Luke. I mean, really, he's toughing it out for Paul. Take Mark. Mark who? How many know which Mark this is? Okay. How many have heard the Gospel of Mark? Same guy. This is Mark, sister's son to Barnabas, as we're told. Where's that verse? Sister's son to Barnabas, Ephesians 6:12, I believe. No, sorry, Colossians 4:10, sister's son to Barnabas. This is John Mark. When they started on their missionary journey, John Mark went with Paul and Barnabas, and as they got there across into the bottom of Turkey, Asia Minor, they began to go into the territory and begin to go up in elevation towards Antioch and Syria, and somewhere in that period, things got pretty tough. It's some rough areas, according to historians, and John Mark said, you know what? I got things in Jerusalem I have to take care of. See you, bye. And off he went. And so he left. He went back to Jerusalem. Well, they finished the missionary journey, went all through, and Acts 15 rolls around. They deal with some issues, and then they decide, well, let's go visit the churches again that we planted, see how they're doing. And Barnabas said, hey, let's take John Mark again. And Paul said, not good. Barnabas said, come on. Paul said, no way. And the contention got so sharp between them, what happened? They split. Barnabas took John Mark, headed down west again towards the islands, and Paul took Silas and went back up through those churches. And so for a while, there was this bit of a falling out between Paul and John Mark. And some argue that perhaps John Mark was even under a cloud because of this dispute, this issue. But now here, at the end of the game for Paul, he can say, only Luke is with me. Take Mark, John Mark, bring him with you. Look at this. For he is profitable to me for the ministry. Sounds like he's been restored. What do you think? Isn't it nice to know we can blow it and God can still use us? Tychicus, have I sent to Ephesus, which if Timothy is there, he'd still be there to cover him. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when you come, bring it with you. Why would he want a cloak? It's cold. Prison. When thou comest, bring it with you, and the books, but especially the parchments. You think he's looking for the National Enquirer? That kind of parchment? No, the Word of God. Bring the Word of God with you. Bring the books, the parchments, things he was studying. Alexander, who's he? The coppersmith. What do we know about him? He did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Try that next time in traffic. May the Lord record you according to your works. You turkey. Doesn't say that, but. You know, that sounds sort of like vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, not the sheep. Now, who is he? Well, some say he worked with Demetrius the silversmith at Ephesus when they had that whole thing with great as Diana of the Ephesians. That's one option. The other is when Alexander was dragged in before the group there in the theater, that's the Alexander. Another one is the Alexander mentioned in 1 Timothy. Whoever it is, it's clear to Timothy. For us, we're not quite sure. But it's Alexander the coppersmith, and you want to watch out for him, just in case you meet him. Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. May the Lord reward him according to his works. God will sort it out. Yeah, I got to ask it. What would happen to you if he rewarded you according to your works? You know, in John chapter 6, they came to Jesus and said, what work should we do that we might work the works of God? And his answer was, this is the work of God, that you believe upon him whom he has sent. There's only one, quote, work God would accept, that we would believe. And we're told in Ephesians 2:8, it's for by grace through faith you've been saved. That's not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works lest any man should boast. What work can we do? Believe. Well, that's not really work. Bingo. It's by faith. It's a gift. The Lord reward him according to his works. And by the way, if we have believed, he's going to reward us according to our works, our faith. Of whom be thou ware also. Watch out, he's still a bad dude. For he hath greatly withstood our words, and he is still a problem. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. Remember Romans, one whole chapter is all these people he's greeting. Romans, he's never even been to the town, and he's got a whole chapter of greeting them. Anybody ever read that? Here, when it comes time for him to defend himself, nobody stuck around with him. Too dangerous. Some argue the first defense might have been the charge of being a lead arsonist, and that he might have gotten out of that because he could prove, I wasn't even in town. We're not sure, but at my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it be not laid to their charge. God would forgive them. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me. Hey, watch this. You want to see Paul steal something? Watch this. Go to Acts chapter 7. Left turn. Acts chapter 7. He stole something from Stephen. Just when Stephen thought no one was listening. There, that young man named Saul of Tarsus, who was guarding the garments of those who killed Stephen, consenting to his death, Paul heard something in verse 60. And it shows up in one of the last few verses of 2 Timothy. They stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and he cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. When Stephen had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul was consenting unto his death. He was there. Now look back at our chapter. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it be not, what? Laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, and by the way, will people forsake you at times? Yeah, they will. Sometimes even spouse can let you down. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me. Strengthen me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. There are times where God gets us alone because God wants us alone, so we only have him. There are times God allows the circumstances in your life to just smack you in the face because it's all you have is him. And the rich seasons, the Lord stood with me. If he died and was buried and now he's standing with Paul, what does that mean? He's risen and he is alive. Everybody got that? How many didn't get that? Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me. He's alive. And strengthened me. What more do you need? That by me the preaching might be fully known. Paul once again gives Nero the gospel, most degree. That all the Gentiles might hear. He preached it. Go, Paul. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. A lot of speculation. Was he in the arena? Was he literally delivered? We'll have to ask him in heaven. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Hey, remember that thing about I'm afraid to really lay down my life and go where God would tell me to go? What happens if something bad happens? Let me tell you what you should do. The Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me even unto his heavenly kingdom. Reminds me of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Forget the music, King. We're not bowing down to your God, your idol. It's just in your image. It's not going to happen. So go ahead and heat the furnace. You know what? Our God is able to deliver us. And if he doesn't, he'll deliver us anyway. We're going to be with him. The Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me into his heavenly kingdom. To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Salute Priscilla and Aquila. Throughout the book of Acts, they minister alongside Paul. They're with him from Corinth, going to Ephesus. It seems perhaps they're still there. They have churches in their homes. They instruct the apostles, they instruct the disciples, They were friends with some of the apostles they traveled through. When Apollos came through there and was presenting only the baptism of John, they heard him, they pulled him aside, explained the way of truth to him more thoroughly. And then Apollos, because rather than shame the man, they sat with him, they discipled him. Then he went to Corinth and he was powerfully used by their ministry. A husband and wife team that just opened their home and they're mentioned. Aquila and Priscilla. Salute the household of Onesiphorus, who we heard about in chapter 1, that he was not ashamed of Paul's chain or bonds, and search for him diligently. Erastus, who many think is the treasurer or chamberlain at Corinth, abode at Corinth. Trophimus, have I left at Miletum sick? First thing, remember when Paul was in the temple, and the Jews from Asia, that would be Turkey, saw him, and they went nuts and said, men and brethren of Israel, help this man, this man who's teaching against Moses and against the temple and against this place, and he brought a Gentile into the temple. Remember that? How many really know that story? I got Alex. I got Lisa. I got Julie. You guys have some reading to do. It's the book of Acts. Trophimus was the one that was with Paul that they thought came into the temple area. Trophimus, here's the man. Go back and check it out there. Look at Acts. Hang on, I'll get it for you. I'll help you out here, a little help. 19, is it? Is that what everybody's got, 19? Who's got it in their margin? 19. Go to Acts 19 when you get a chance. Go home and read it because we only got 4 minutes. You guys need to read the book of Acts. Trophimus, have I left at Miletum sick? Wait a second. Remember when Paul's at Ephesus there and God was doing unusual miracles through him? So that as he's working there and he'd wipe his brow and put the rag down, somebody would take it and run away and they'd hand it to someone who's sick. Here's from Paul. It is, and they'd be healed. Remember that? Sweat cloths, aprons, Acts 20, Acts 19 around there again. Anybody? Well, then why'd he leave him sick? Why don't you say, Trophimus, I sent a prayer cloth to or a sweatband and he'll get better in a few days. I left him in Miletum. Was it the sweatband that did the healing? No, it was faith in the God that Paul represented who was using the sweatband. It was the point of contact, but it was God who healed. Notice, please, did Paul have a genuine healing ministry? How many are not sure? So why didn't Trophimus be healed? Why wasn't he healed? Because healing is according to God's will, God's sovereignty. Now listen, dear brothers and sisters, does that mean we shouldn't pray for healing? No, we should always seek the Lord for healing. James tells us, if there's any sick among you, let him call for the elders of the church. Let them anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick. The Lord will raise him up. If he's committed, sins will be forgiven him. Pray for one another. You may be healed. And so we're to pray for one another. We're to ask God for healing. Because does God still heal today? Yes. Let me answer with a verse. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And where the gospel of Christ is proclaimed, there will be deliverance from demons and healing for those individuals and changed lives and all these other things. Signs and wonders should follow the proclaiming of the gospel. And not just through the leadership of the pastorate, through the body of Christ. So we should still be asking the Lord to move among the church supernaturally. You know, I'm reading about the Welsh revival, just extra reading there, and how God would start in a little corner with people that were just loving God, and God began to work in their hearts, and they began to deal with all conscious and known sin in their lives. They began to turn from it and seek the Lord, and suddenly God just poured out by His Spirit, and suddenly people's lives are being changed. People are being healed. Bars are shutting down. Prostitution houses are going out of business because hearts are being changed because people are on fire again for Jesus. And it started first with a revival in the church, and then it went to the lost. God wants to do a work. We're in some dark times. And so for those of us who name the name of Christ, we should depart from iniquity and walk in the light as He is in the light and be children of the light so that God can work through us as we studied last week, easily used, ready to go. Not like bread with ketchup and American cheese in the oven. Ready to go and clean. So God can use us. Trophimus, I've left at Miletum sick. In this case, God chose not to heal him. perhaps to protect Trophimus from trouble in Rome. Do thy diligence to come before winter. Again, probably the fall of 67 AD. Eubulus greeteth thee, and Puns. What's your name? Puns. We can make fun of him, but he was a distinguished Roman. If you have the time, do a little digging. Puns was, if we think he's the same person, a very distinguished individual. Linus, perhaps you've heard of him. Claudia, who was a Briton, who most agree was married to Puns. Again, people of note in Britain. And all their brethren. Timothy, the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. And if that prayer of Paul's is fulfilled, then Paul can know the next generation of the church will do well. If Christ be with us, who can be against us? The Lord Jesus Christ be with thy spirit. Grace, dear son in the faith, be unto you. Amen. Shortly after this, just a mere months, Paul would be taken out to the Ostian Way. Because he's a Roman citizen, he would be beheaded. And he would literally have his eyes shut for a moment on this earth and only to look up and be in the presence of God. I wonder if Stephen was the first in line to greet him. Let's stand and pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the scripture. Thank you for Paul. He knew that there was no good thing that dwelled in him. Lord, I pray for the Paul or Timothy here in this room this evening or listening. They're afraid of what you have prepared them for. The deep depths of their heart, they sense gifting. But with their minds, they sense fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of sound mind, love, power. If you're here and the Lord has been calling you, you'll know it's a call because it won't go away, and no matter how much you try to rationalize it out, excuse yourself from it, but give God excuses why somebody else would be a better fit. Today, if you hear the Lord's voice, don't harden your heart like Israel, but say, yes, Lord. First to salvation, and then to lordship and ministry. In Jesus' name, amen.